So are there any announcements that anybody wants to make today? I think we had, well, Francois's got one, but he's up in the balcony. Francois, do you want me to talk about your... So Francois's got a friend who offers at-home care, and he has brochures for that. It's called Bright Hope. She's going to be meeting with me, and she might even come in and talk with us. I haven't heard, we haven't had time to get together yet. But I'm sorry, Francois was going to present it, but he went upstairs to help with the sound. So pick up a brochure from him, and he can tell you some more about it. And did everybody get their small cardstock and pencils? If you didn't, they're in the back in a basket. And we have an announcement or a video that we're going to play that Francois created that tells us about the series we're entering into. Lent is often known as a time for giving something up in order to make room in our lives for spiritual practices. So rather than just giving up something this Lent, the scriptures ask us to consider all that Jesus is up to and all that we can be up to in his name. So this Lent, we will celebrate the small things that we can do right now to be able to respond to God's call in our place and for our time. So the first Sunday of the series brings us to the moment at which Jesus comes up out of the waters of baptism to hear, "You are my beloved." And we are called to come up out of the depths with Jesus, out of whatever it is that seeks to keep us underwater, and we're called to come up and know that we too are beloved of God. So come up, for now is the time to be fully who you are created to be for the sake of the world. Let us come together in prayer. Loving God, we come before you needing to feel lighter. We are weighed down with expectations and difficult news. Sometimes it's our own doing that weighs us down. In this moment of quiet, we lift to you those things we'd like to give up for good, for the sake of the good.
Let us hear assurance in what the psalmist proclaims through Psalm 25. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. O God, in you I trust. Do not let me be put to shame. Do not let my enemies exult over me. Make me to know your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation. For you I wait all day long. Be mindful of your mercy, O Lord, and of your steadfast love, for they have been from of old. And do not remember the sins of my youth or my transgressions. According to your steadfast love, remember me, for your goodness' sake, O Lord. Good and upright is the Lord. In the name of Christ, you are forgiven.
Big question for you.
What would that be?
What's up?
Isn't that getting a little carried away?
Well, that is slang for what is up. Isn't that what we're talking about during Lent?
For sure. I like that word. And I'm so glad that you are listening to what we're talking about during Lent. Yes, we're going to be talking about what are we as a congregation and as individuals up to.
You know, I like the word up, you know. I can say I'm fed up. As a teacher, I can tell kids to, I better not use that one. I'm up to something.
That happens a lot.
Yes, yes.
And when I say, can you please show up?
I'm here. I'm here today.
Yep.
I'm showed up.
There we go.
There you go.
So in our gospel reading today, something special is up with Jesus. When he is baptized and he comes up out of the water, a voice from the heavens declares, "You are my beloved, and I am with you. I am well pleased."
Oh, that sounds fantastic. Yeah. I would love to hear that. You know, that would make my day.
Yeah, it's nice to hear when people are proud of you and they say that they love you. And it feels so goodly, but I think it's important for you to know that we are all proud of you, too. Yes.
Even Judy?
God is up to something good through your life. And like just this week alone, when you took time to shovel other people's parking spots, and when you shoveled out the church twice during the snow. And when you think about it, everybody here is up to something good. most of the time, we have people that are checking in on others. We have people picking up people and driving them to appointments when they need a ride. We have people that donate food, make food, serve food. We have people that even bring in socks to be recycled. And we even had somebody who was sending out lovely Valentine's Day cards this year. We are up to a lot of good things. No matter how small we might think those things are, the good things that we get up to in this world make the world so much better. It uplifts the spirits of others.
Oh, like the balloons here in the sanctuary.
That's why we have hot air balloons.
That's right. When we rise up to something good, everything seems a little lighter.
That's right, and that's what we'll all be getting up to this Lent, and everyone is welcome to come and rise up with us.
Our gospel reading today is taken from Mark chapter 1, verses 9 through 15. In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." And the Spirit immediately drove him out into the wilderness. He was in the wilderness 40 days, tempted by Satan, and he was with the wild beasts, and the angels waited on him. Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news." The word of God for the people of God.
Spread your cross, we are your slaves.
So let us pray. God of our hearts, not of our outer garments, nor our church structures, nor our programs, or even our human plans, you are the only one who truly knows us. You are the one who can meet us where we are and make us well. So as we enter into this first Sunday of Lent, and as we seek to unpack your holy word, we ask that you work within us, opening us more fully to your love, your life, your ways. And through the time spent in your word this day, help us to rise up in ways that bring us more fully into kinship with you. Amen. So you might have noticed that as we've opened Lent this year, we have returned to a reading that we focused on what seems like just a little bit of time ago, at the beginning of Epiphany. And this wasn't a mistake, for it is the season of Epiphany. It's the season of Epiphany that the waters of baptism, they invite us to move beyond wherever it is that we find ourselves. And it is through the season of Lent that the waters of baptism invite us to journey with Jesus to the cross. Both seasons inspire us to rise up with Christ through the waters of baptism. Now, of course, as often happens when plans are made and plans are laid out, as the Spirit soars along with us in the ebb and flow of life, sometimes our plans will shift and they'll add new dimensions to where it is that we think we're going. And this is what happened this past week. I had the opportunity to hear Dr. Julia O'Brien, who helped to shape my seminary education at Lancaster Theological Seminary, and who continues to shape the lives of many others who attend there. Well, her presentation covered the Hebrew scriptures that are covered in our lectionary. That is, the lectionary is the suggested readings that we pastors go through to choose what it is that we're going to preach about and talk about. And though our formal worship plans, they don't include any of the texts that Julia was referring to, but I wanted to take time today to share a bit about what it is that Dr. O'Brien had to say. It's really important. There is this common interpretation and understanding of our scriptures that leads us to read and understand what we call the Old Testament in a way that leads to a belief that what we call the New Testament is a kind of replacement of the old. Have you heard of that thought before? The new passes up the old, replaces it. And even the terminology new and old can seem to reinforce this understanding. After all, don't we often say that we need to get new things to replace those old things that are in our house? Understanding our Bible in this way has provided a lot of room for a lot of misinterpretations. And those misinterpretations have added fuel to the fires of hatred and discrimination over the centuries. But the truth be told, that both testaments are equally important. They are both equally our story. Both testaments connect us more fully to the depth and the meaning of who it is that God is and what our relationship with the divine is all about. So you might be wondering, well, where did this understanding of old and new come from? So we need to back up a little bit and look at a little bit of history, because when it comes to the formation of the Christian church, the story is often told that in Genesis, God makes a covenant with Adam and Eve, and they don't follow through. But God doesn't give up, and God keeps extending covenant after covenant. There's Noah and the ark and his family and the sign of the rainbow. And it goes on down through the years to Abraham and Sarah with the promise to make a great nation that will come from their union. And every covenant that God extends is about the formation of relationships. relationships that can be bonded between the people and God. And it seems like every covenant is eventually broken in one way or another by the people, not by God. And the story moves forward across the generations to the book of Jeremiah. And the prophet Jeremiah, he sees the importance of the relationship with the divine. And he sees how the people had fallen away from God. So he makes a declaration. He makes a declaration that a new covenant needs to take place. A new covenant that would help solidify the relationship between God and the people once and for all. But as the story is told, God eventually chooses to reject Israel. And this is where Jesus enters into the story. God, we understand, sends Jesus, and he sends this new Jesus as a messenger with this set of agreements that come and get presented to us in order to form a new relationship with a new people. But this way of understanding the testaments to our faith is a dangerous way to interpret and understand our scriptures. It's dangerous for us to even understand God in this way. It can easily lead us to understand that those in the Old Testament got it all wrong. They kept messing up until God gave up on them. And it can easily lead us to interpret the promises that are revealed in the New Testament, or shall we say, replacement testament, is only for those who identify as Christians, those who get it right. And it's easy to find evidence of this kind of thinking. The early church depicted that Christianity is the right way, the only way. And some churches and even Christian sects today, they will still preach that their way is the only way, even in front of other Christian churches. And they justify this belief because the story tells us that the Jews rejected Jesus as the Messiah, so they are not only wrong, they are willfully wrong. They chose not to recognize the truth in Jeremiah's prophecy in their own scriptures. But this way of understanding the testaments is known as supersessionism. Supersessionism, or replacement theology, is the opinion that the Christian church has superseded the nation of Israel, and that Christians now assume the solitary position as God's chosen covenanted people. Let that soak in for a little bit. This understanding is so problematic on so many levels. It leads to this kind of an insider and outsider theology, where only one group gets to be in relationship, and the others, well, just too bad, it's their fault. Now, perhaps you're already thinking about events that have taken place throughout history and even in recent history, where we can see that this line of thinking can lead to dangerous, dangerous events. Our news feeds are often filled with images of hatred and division that leads to violence. And some rally together blatantly shouting their us versus them ideology. And scenes like what took place in Charlottesville, Virginia in 2017, perhaps you remember that? I don't think I'll ever forget watching that on the news. People lined the streets chanting, "Jews will not replace us." Do you remember that? And where violence eventually erupted, and where three died, and dozens of others were injured. Perhaps you, like me, can still hear those chants that spewed out hatred in our newscasts. Now, of course, there are layers and layers of history that cause those types of ideologies to be formed. There's lots that goes on behind this kind of hatred and discrimination. But we need to be aware of the way that our scriptures have been used to add fuel to that fire. interpreting scriptures in a way that leads us to understanding that God would ever replace one individual or group with another individual or group. It doesn't only contradict what we believe about our loving God, it also empowers extremists to perpetrate heinous acts against those that they believe have done wrong, those that they believe are on the outside. And I personally don't believe, I cannot believe that God ever intended for humanity to become so divided and filled with such hatred for one another. Since the very beginning, God's intentions are clear. They have always centered around connection, relationship, kinship. And that's what God's covenants were all about, relationships. A covenant is an oath, kind of, you know, the covenants we make when we're married. A covenant is an oath that brings people together. It brings people together in ways that go far beyond any other kind of relationship. And when a covenant is forged, there is this physical kind of buy-in. And it's a buy-in that moves the relationship into something more, something that takes us beyond even what many of us have with our biological families. For a covenant is a choice. And it's a choice in which biologically and non-biologically related individuals can freely come together to form an unbreakable bond of kinship. Kinship. These are relationships like no other. And this kind of covenant language, it flows through the Hebrew Testament, and it flows all the way through into the Christian Testament. You see, what we are given throughout scriptures is an image of God continually coming, continually committing to invite humanity into a deep, meaningful relationship, a deep, meaningful kinship. And it isn't forced, and it isn't accidental. It isn't something that can be replaced. And when we choose to be in covenant, our lives indeed are changed forever. Jesus' life isn't about forging a new relationship with a new people. Jesus is God incarnate, living and loving humanity the same way as always. But this time, God comes on human feet with human hands and heart, offering another covenant, extending another covenant, just like he had in the past. A covenant that once again invites God's children into a deeper, more meaningful relationship, a kinship. God looks at all children of this earth, and God sees promise and potential. God looks at each and every one of us every time we rise, and God sees and feels hope. After all, it is it's the wondrous hands of God that have shaped life since the very beginning. And it is God's love that continually reaches out to continue shaping us, continuing to beckon us into deeper, fuller relationships, inviting us, no, actually yearning for us to enter into kinship. And this yearning for relationship includes all people, whether Jewish or Muslim, Christian, atheist, agnostic, or whether our skin is brown or off-white, or slightly tan, or any other color, or whether we are married, single, divorced, young or old, whether we have problems or whether we don't think we have problems, we all do, we know that. Whether male, whether we're female, whether we're hetero or homo or anywhere in between, somewhere, or even maybe outside of those things. God's love is limitless. We need to hear that again. God's love is limitless. Can you join me in saying that? God's love is limitless. Preach it. Doesn't knowing that feel so good? God didn't create us from cookie cutter shapes, monochrome palettes with single-minded brains and hearts. No, God has always created and continues to create a wide array of shapes and colors and perspectives. And this is what makes our world so complex, so wonderful, so complete. And God wants each and every one who walks this earth to come as we are into covenant, into relationship, into kinship with our Creator. Now, God doesn't expect those relationships to look the same any more than we look the same. It is the purposeful and diverse uniqueness that we bring into us, into the relationship with us, that makes the relationship. And when we bring ourselves in covenant with God in this way, we will rise up to more than we could ever imagine possible. And so it is with our focus text that we found in our gospel reading today, that we are invited to dive in with Jesus just as we are and go down deeply into the waters of baptism. And then we are invited to emerge into kinship in ways that open our senses to the heavens that are opening up all around us. And it's a way for us to feel a slight breeze of the Spirit descending upon us as we rise. And it's a way for us to be able to hear the heavens cry out, saying, "Welcome, my child. Welcome, my beloved one. Welcome to kinship. Welcome to love. Welcome to God." Now, this is what Jesus' life, ministry, and death is all about. This kinship is for one and for all. So let us come as we are, and let us join as one, as with all of God's people. And let us rise up out of the waters of baptism. Because rising up out of those waters isn't a once and done kind of experience. Each and every day that we rise from our pillows, each and every moment that we walk on this earth, we are invited to emerge. We're invited to rise up. We're invited to open ourselves more fully to this wonderful, precious new life that we are gifted. Now, the balloons that are in the sanctuary, and they'll be up throughout Lent, are a way an invitation for each of us to climb on board and allow ourselves to rise up in different ways, each and every one of us, into deeper, fuller relationships. And as we do, we will find ourselves coming up out of the depths of whatever threatens to pull us down under. And as we allow ourselves and we open ourselves to rise up, we too can be assured that we are God's beloved, equal with all of humanity. And as we do, we will begin a journey that seeks to embrace God's kinship to its fullest. So, my beloved friends, come up. The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God is near. Rise up and believe in the good news. Amen. So, Lent is a time for us to focus on spiritual practices. And Lent is a way for us to make room for relationships with the holy, to grow and to deepen. And this year, with the regular activities, along with the regular activities we have each week and every month, we have a special Wednesday evening study that everyone is invited to. And we have special journals to take home for quiet reflection. The point is that Lent is an opportunity for us to get up to something that will help us to grow deeper in our faith. And those who use the journals to spend time in reflection and prayer are encouraged to light a candle or have some incense if they're comfortable doing that, to kind of remind you that this space, this time, this reflection is a different kind of prayer time. And that connects us to our practice that the ancient people mentioned by the psalmist in chapter 141. I call upon you, O Lord. Come quickly to me. Give ear to my voice when I call to you. Let my prayer rise up as incense before you, and the lifting of my hands as an evening sacrifice. Now we're going to be singing Psalm 141 as our prayer song throughout Lent. And this Sunday, we'll listen to it once, and then we'll repeat it. We call upon you, O God, in the midst of all the contours of our lives, those that feel life-giving as well as those that pain us. For all of life is filled with joy and sorrow, of living and loving. Especially in times when life feels like the difficulties of journey in the desert, we pray that we can be up to something good for ourselves, our neighborhoods, and our world. And so this week, we start with thanksgiving for the acts of goodness that are all around us. We thank you for family. We thank you for grandchildren. We thank you for safe and interesting travel. We thank you for Elizabeth's birthday. And we see your goodness in the life of Dick Veith, and we feel gratitude. We see your goodness in family. And we see your goodness in Tina, and we thank you. And let my prayers rise up. We call upon you, O God, to give us the strength and the courage to be up to something good for the sake of the good. In this moment, in our mind's eye, we imagine and offer our commitment to one small thing this week that will lift someone up, elevate and affirm the good when we see it, and bring a bit more calm or joy where we are. And if we find that we're not up to that, we pray that we can accept the goodness of others and feel your encouraging love flowing through. We call upon you, God, to incline your ear and extend your love and healing power for these laments and these concerns. We ask for you to intercede for the victims of recent mass shootings, including Lakewood and Kansas City. We ask that you be with Robin and Gavin and Matthew. We ask that you be with Zach and Ashley. We ask for your presence with Jeff and Sandy. For Lois, for the Suzuki family. We ask for your presence with Mike and Susan, for Darren and Angel. Let my prayers rise up. In the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Let my prayers rise up. Friends, during this series, we will offer support for our church activities, mission, and budget in the usual ways, but we'll also be creating a visual that features uplifting messages to the world. So as we listen to our offertory music today, you are invited to write a message that you want to put out into the world. You were given a piece of paper or cardstock to write these things on. And you can put these into the basket that sits in the chancel as you leave worship. So let us rise up with our thoughts. And let us pray. Spirit of belovedness, in ways that extend what we can do exponentially, we ask you to multiply these gifts we hold up today and that which will be held up in the week ahead. Through them, may many be uplifted, our gifts transformed into your voice of love in the world. Amen. Into the world, knowing that as a disciple of Jesus, as a beloved child of the Holy One, and an heir to the Holy Spirit, with angels uplifting and attending you, that you have all that you need to be up to something. So when somebody asks you, "What are you up to?" you can respond, "With God's help, I am up to something good." And let all the people say, Amen.